When Trotsky was assassinated by a Stalin agent in August of 1940, he left unfinished what was really one of the remarkable books ever written by a Marxist or anyone else. I'm referring to his biography of Stalin. This is a work which is really unique, I think, in the whole of Marxist literature. It deals, of course, with the subject of a man that is well known to history as one of the most monstrous dictators of all times. And yet this man emerged as the leader of a state which was established through proletarian revolution as one of the most democratic worker states in history, a product of the Russian Revolution. And how could this happen? You see, this is an essential question which many people ask, and they're right to ask. How does it come about that a worker state, that the Russian Revolution, could degenerate in such a way as to produce the dictatorship of one man, and what a monster he was? How did this come about? How did Stalin himself develop from a young revolutionary, which of course he originally was, into the tyrant and the monster which he subsequently became? This, of course, itself, from a human point of view, from a psychological point of view, but above all from a political point of view, is a most important and fascinating subject, and one, as I say, that I believe was not dealt with adequately in all of previous Marxist literature. It is true that the relationship between the individual and historical events has been dealt with, above all, by Karl Marx in his wonderful work, The 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. But here I think Trotsky takes this analysis one step further. He shows how Stalin, as a personality, as an individual, related to the broad historical processes of the Russian Revolution itself. I repeat the question, how could it come about? How could Stalin, who after all was one of the most, the least developed of the Bolshevik leaders, all the other Bolsheviks were intellectuals, were theoreticians, were cultivated people, were of course dedicated revolutionaries, were internationalists who could speak several foreign languages. Stalin, of course, could not speak any foreign language except for Russian. Of course, he was a Georgian, it wasn't his native language, which he spoke badly and with a thick Georgian accent. And yet this individual, the most unlikely candidate, succeeded in taking power in the Soviet Union after the death of Lenin. How could this come about? Well, you see, the answer cannot be explained in terms of Stalin's personality, although there was an attempt subsequently made by Khrushchev and others to blame the degeneration of the revolution on Stalin's cult of personality, so-called. Not so. It's not possible to explain a history purely in terms of individuals and personalities, although, of course, Marxism does not deny the role of the individual in history. Marx explains that history, that men and women make their own history. That's perfectly true. But, of course, they don't make it as free agents. Our ability to affect the processes of history is not purely dependent on ourselves. It's dependent on a whole series, a whole concatenation of objective circumstances. Here, of course, there's an interesting parallel which Trotsky draws, and incidentally, there are some appendices in the present work which have never been published before, where Trotsky elaborates on the analogy with the French Revolution. There is an analogy with the French Revolution in this sense. Every revolution has a period, if you like, the heroic period, where the revolution is going forward, where the masses are actively involved. And in this heroic period of revolutionary ascent, certain individuals are required. Certain qualities are required of individual heroism, of determination, of a broad vision, of a certain idealism. This is the type of qualities which are acquired in the flood tide of the revolution. Yes, but in the ebb tide of the revolution, where the whole thing goes into reverse, where the masses are exhausted, where the revolution has run out of steam, if you like, where there's a general reversal, then other qualities emerge of opportunism, of careerism, of bureaucracy, of toadyism, of servilism, of a lack of imagination, or to sum it up in one word, of mediocrity. Now, Marx actually dealt with this in his book, which I mentioned, the 18th Brumaire of Louis Bonaparte. The French Revolution, of course, in its heyday, required heroes such as Danton, Robespierre, Marat, and others. In the period of decline, you have what? People like Fouché, the arch-careerist, the mediocrity, the police spy, the traitor, the apostate. And it was the same in the Russian Revolution. The ascent of the revolution is characterized by giants, such as Lenin, Trotsky, Bukharin, Zinoviev, Radek, and many others. The ebb of the revolution is characterized by what? Well, precisely by people such as Voroshilov, Molotov, Vyshinsky, the former Menshevik, who later became the prosecutor in the notorious Moscow purge trials, and, of course, Joseph Vissarionovich Djugashvili, known to history as Stalin. Stalin was the chief mediocrity, to put it in that sense, the weak link, the weakest link in the Bolshevik Party leadership, and for that reason, he became the ideal candidate for the caste, for the millions of officials who crawled into power following the death of Lenin, on the basis of the isolation of the revolution under conditions of frightful material and cultural backwardness. It's these conditions that produced Stalin. It wasn't Stalin that produced the conditions. That's perfectly true. I don't think, however, that this exhausts the question, and what is fascinating about Trotsky's book is that he deals with this this in detail, with the enormous painstaking care, a colossal amount of biographical and archival material. He establishes the exact relationship between Stalin as a man, as a personality, and the degeneration, the bureaucratic degeneration of the Russian Revolution itself. If I were to give a personal opinion, I'd put it this way. Was Stalin responsible for the Stalinist degeneration of the Russian Revolution? No, he was not. He was the product of this degeneration. The caste of millions of officials required a leader, a voice, to use the Russian expression, the Führer in German, the Duce in Italian, is the same thing, of one individual who encapsulated the ideas and the morality and the mental limitedness, if you like, of these very millions of officials that he represented. Yes, Stalin was the product of this process, and yet he did determine not the process itself, not the content, but the forms, the particular, peculiarly vicious, brutal, bloody, sadistic nature of that dictatorship, that bureaucratic dictatorship, that undoubtedly was permeated by the personal characteristics of Stalin, the reasons for which Trotsky deals with brilliantly in this wonderful work of Marxist literature. It only remains to me, therefore, to recommend with every possible enthusiasm for every Marxist, for every revolutionary, for every person that wants to fight to change society, and indeed beyond that, to every intelligent man and woman, to every intellectual, to every student of history that wants to understand the reasons for the Russian Revolution and its historical destiny, the decay and ultimately the collapse of the Soviet Union, well, you could not hope to read a more profound, a more interesting, a more inspiring work than this wonderful work, the last contribution of Leon Trotsky to the arsenal, the rich arsenal of Marxist theoretical literature, which is his biography of Stalin.